Lord, as we come to this important part of our service where we can sit and we can listen to your word, listen to the truths that are found therein, and Father, as it compels us and speaks to us and gives us direction of how to live, Father, I pray that we'll just apply it to our lives tonight, that we'll not just sit and listen, but we'll actually take action in what we're hearing tonight. Father, I thank you for the words that you've laid upon my heart. Father, as it goes forth tonight in weakness, Father, I pray that you will use it to stir the hearts of your people and to move on this shore, we pray, giving you thanks always. Amen. Now, we read earlier from 2 Corinthians 5, and we read from verses 13 to 21. And in spite of now, I'm sure you've already understood and gathered from some of my sermons and those who've attended some of my Bible studies, you will realize that I am a great fan of the Apostle Paul. I love his writings. And I have to say, if any of the courses that I was intrigued by and found the most interesting while I was in college, I would have to say that it was the Apostle Paul and his writings. But I've entitled my sermon tonight, A New You for 2017. Now, as you can tell, this was supposed to be last week's sermon, but because of the weather, it didn't go ahead. But this is what God has laid upon my heart, and I feel that we need to look at this tonight as well. It's hard to believe that we are already 3 weeks into the year of 2017. It's the third Sunday. It's actually hard to believe that. The trees are all taken down. Well, I've still got one left in the rec room, actually. It's not all gone. The decorations are mostly put away. The chocolates and the junk food are all eaten. And if they're not eaten, they're taken out of the house altogether, right? It's a new year. And with a new year, for most of us, comes a desire to be different than we were in the last year. The new year always brings with it new hope and new excitement. For some, they look at the new year with optimism. And as they look at this new year that is untouched, it brings with it new possibilities and with it new opportunities. Now, if you've been watching your TV and you've been turned into one of our American affiliates and the American networks, there has been great talk about this great possibility of a new president, depending on who you're listening to and who you're talking to, of course. But if you've heard anything, you've heard that there's great anticipation for this inauguration of the 45th president of the United States, Donald Trump. Now, I was listening to one of the radio stations, I think it was yesterday, as I was at Costco waiting to fill up for gas, and they were saying that he's having a hard time to get anybody to perform at his inauguration, anybody who's big. Elton John has turned him down, Celine Dion, and a few other of the big ones have all turned him down. So he's having trouble getting these people to perform at his inauguration. So there are those who are preparing to be out with the old, out with Obama, Obamacare and everything that he has, and in with the new president, Donald Trump. Now, I'm not endorsing Donald Trump tonight by any stretch. Don't take it that way. But if you listen to the media, there is hype, some of it good, some of it bad, about this new president who will take over in just 5 more days. Even here in Canada, there has been a great deal of excitement and much enthusiasm around the year of 2017. And if you watched any of the Canadian networks on New Year's Eve, then you would have heard and seen some of the celebrations that took place as we kicked off the Canada 150 celebration. For those of you who may not know much about it, they're celebrating 150 years of Confederation. And it's something that has great pomp and circumstance. And as we were in Ottawa this summer, there was a lot of the streets that were closed because they're doing renovations and construction. And a lot of the buildings are getting new facelifts and cleaned as they prepare for this momentous year of 150 years of Confederation. Our text this evening talks about the new. We read in 2 Corinthians 5 and 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, and the new is here. I would like us this evening to look at what Christ desires to do in our lives as we embark upon this new year of 2017. Christ desires to give us a new love. Maybe some of you already have love. But he desires to give you a new love if you don't have love already. He desires to give you a new life. For those who are living in the old way and have the old way of thinking, he desires to give you a new life. And he desires to give you a new labor tonight. The first thing I want us to look at is Jesus Christ will give you a new love. Paul talked about this love in verse 13 and 14 when he said, if we are out of our mind, as some say, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For Christ's love compels us because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. In other words, when Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins, he took our death. And when we receive him as Savior and Lord, we also receive his kind of love. A love so big that it is willing to die on the cross for us. A love so big in verse 13 that sometimes it seems beside itself or just plain crazy. It's a love that loves the unlovable. A love that loves people when they let us down. A love that loves people who are different from us. And a love that loves the lost. That's what God wants us to do in every believer's life. He wants to give you a love that is, as it says in 14, speaks of a love that constrains us. It compels, it controls, it presses us to treat people in amazing ways. A few years ago, a little boy attended a Sunday school. And when his parents decided to move to another part of the city, this little fellow still attended the same Sunday school. And although it meant a long, tiresome walk each day, he decided to go there. A friend asked him why he went so far, and he told them, or when she told them that there was plenty of others just as good near his home. You've heard that, haven't you? There's plenty of good just near your home. Why are you going such a distance? And this is what the little fellow responds to his friend. Because they love a fellow over there. They love a fellow over there. Love makes a difference. And folks, tonight, if we want to be a church that's on fire, a church that's growing, if we want to be a church that shows others that we love, it has to start in here. We have to love each other. If one of our brothers, if one of our sisters are hurting, we need to be standing behind them and encouraging them. We need to be building people up in the faith. We need to have a love that loves everybody. If only we could have or could make the world believe that we love them, there would be fewer empty churches tonight. And the smaller of our population who have never darkened the church doors, we need to let love replace duty in our church. We have to love. And in this new year, that's what we want to do. We want to love people more. I want to get out into this community, and my heart is oppressed as I've been praying about this year and just trying to figure out what do I need to do to try to grow this church. What does God want me and Charlene to do as pastors in this church? But not only Charlene and I as the pastors of this church, those who call this church your home, you who attend this service, or anybody who is affiliated with the Salvation Army in Lower Island Cove, it has to be up on your shoulders. It can't be just Charlene and I doing the work. It has to be about everybody being about the Father's business. It's not about us. It's about kingdom building. We need to be out into this community. We need to be in the highways and the byways, and we need to be showing others that we love them, that God loves them, and we can make a difference. This church can be bursting at its seams. There's no reason why it can't. There's so many people on the shore who need a new vision. They need Christ, and they need us as Christ believers to be busy about Christ's work. The second thing that we can get in this new year and that Jesus Christ wants to give us is a new life. We can get a good look at this new life in verse 15 to 17, where Paul tells us, and he died for all that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and who was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view, though we once regarded Christ in this way. We do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The new creation has come, the old is gone, and the new is here. When we open the door of our heart and to receive Jesus He gives us a brand new life. We really are born again. And in verse 15, there is a new order to our life. Paul said, Jesus died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves. It's not about us. It's got nothing to do with us. It's all about what Christ done on the cross. Christ came as a babe in Bethlehem, and like I said, we just celebrated Christmas. He came as that babe with one intention, to die on the cross of Calvary that we might have life, and that we might have it more abundantly tonight. The new life has new order and a new outlook. Paul talked about this new outlook on life in verse 16. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we have known Christ according to the flesh. Yet now we know him, thus no longer. What this means is that we see everything in a brand new way. The New Living Translation states Paul's words in verse 16 like this. We have stopped evaluating others by what the world thinks about them. Once I mistakenly thought of Christ that way, talking about his old life, talking about that he persecuted the church and persecuted Christ. But when he saw all the new way, there was a change, and as though we were merely a human being. How differently I think about him now. He looked at him with old eyes. But on that road to Damascus, something changed in the life of Paul. And he no longer saw Christ as a human being. He saw him as Savior, Lord, Messiah. The promised Messiah that they had long waited for was in his midst. When Christ comes into our lives, he changes us completely. The King James Version says in this of verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. We cast off the old self, all that is associated with sin and the things that would separate us from God. We no longer desire to do the things that we did before we accepted Christ. Our passion is to serve him and live according to his pattern. We have made a choice to be out with the old and in with the new. Billy Graham said the strongest principle of life, that blessings lie in our choice. Our life is the sum result of all the choices we make, both consciously and unconsciously. If we can control the process of choosing, we can take control of all aspects of our life. We can find the freedom that comes from being in charge of our life. So start with what is right rather than what is acceptable. If you don't make a decision, time will make it for you. And time will always decide against you. Let me read that again. If you don't make a decision, then time will make it for you. And time will always decide against you. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day to accept new life, accept Christ. The third thing is Jesus Christ will give you a new life. He will give you a new love. But most importantly, he will give you a new labor. Paul talks about this new labor in verses 18 to 21. All this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. We all have a work to do. God desires that we be about the Father's business. For those of us who have accepted this work of salvation which Christ accomplished on the cross, we need to ensure that we are living our lives appropriately so that those without Christ are unable to find fault in us. We ought not to be stumbling blocks to the weak, as Paul alludes to in 1 Corinthians 8 and 9. Our lives and our living must always show forth the love of God. Max Lucado, and I'm a lover of Max Lucado's writing, and in his book, When God Whispers Your Name, he tells the story of John Eglin. He was a tailor who was also a deacon in his church in Colchester, England. When John woke up on a January Sunday in 1850, the town was covered in snow, much like we woke up to last Sunday morning. And he thought about staying home. Who wouldn't? Most of us did, right? We all did, actually. But John wanted to be faithful. So he put on his hat and coat and he walked 6 miles to church. Only 13 people made it that morning. There was 12 members, one visitor, and even the preacher was snowed in. Someone suggested they go home, but John would have none of that. They'd come this far, they would have the service. Besides, they had a visitor, a 13-year-old boy. But who would preach? Well, John was the only deacon, so the job fell to him. And he preached, even though he had never preached before. John stumbled through his 10-minute sermon. He read from Isaiah 45:22, "Look to me and be saved, all the you ends of the earth, for I am God, and there is no other." John closed his message by looking at the young visitor teenagers and saying, "Young man, look to Jesus Christ. You have nothing to do but to look and to live." It was just what God wanted the young visitor to hear. John said, "Look to Jesus." And the young man did. Young Charles Spurgeon got saved that snowy day and grew up to become one of the greatest preachers who ever lived. Thousands and thousands of people who have been saved because of his ministry. And the church where he pastored in London is still going strong today. All because a man who had never preached before was a faithful ambassador for Jesus. Tonight, on this the third Sunday of this new year, would you like to have a new you for a new year? Are you tired of living your life without Christ? You see, once we accept Christ into our lives, we are a changed people. The old is gone, and we are made new. I found this illustration, and I debated if I should use it or not, but it intrigued me by the message at the end of it. And the illustration talks about not an intellectual man, not a very intelligent man or anything, but he was saved through the work of the Salvation Army. And he went regularly to the Army Citadel, and one day he came home looking very sad. His wife said to him, "What's the matter?" He said, "I just noticed that all the people in the Salvation Army wear red sweaters, and I don't have a red sweater." Now, he was referring to the Guernsey. I'm sure some of you would remember the Guernsey, if not all of you. She said, "I'll knit one for you." So she knitted him a red sweater. Problem solved, right? The next Sunday, after he went to the Citadel, he still wasn't happy. And his wife said, "What's wrong this time?" He said, "I just noticed that all their red sweaters have yellow writing on them." Now, these people were both illiterate, husband and wife. But she said, "Don't worry. I'll embroider some writing for you." The man's wife had no idea what the letters said, and she couldn't read anyway. So, copying a sign from a store window opposite their home, she embroidered the words of the store sign into the red sweater. Now, does anybody know what the writing on the red sweater is? Anybody brave enough to shout it out? Yeah? Blood and fire. Blood and fire is what the writing is on the red Guernsey. That's not what the woman wrote. When he came back the next Sunday, she said, "Did they like your sweater?" "Oh, they loved the sweater. Some of them said they'd like my sweater better than their sweater." What neither of them knew was that the sign in the store window she had copied read, "Under new management." Under new management. That's what it means to get saved. It's what it means to be converted. It's what it means for Christ to enter your life. You're truly under new management. The old is gone. Behold, all things have become new. For those of us who have accepted Christ, we have already experienced these blessings and changes, and we have experienced them new every day. I'm learning something new every day. He's changing me every day into something that he wants me to be. And I'm sure he's doing that in the life of the believer here tonight. Maybe there is one who has not experienced the change that Christ can make in your life. Yes, maybe there's one here tonight who once knew and experienced all that Christ could and can do in your life. But you've taken a step away from Christ. My prayer is this evening that Christ will give you a new love. A love for Him and a love for others. That He will give you a new life. That the old way of living and the old way of thinking will be gone. And God will be the center of everything that you do and everything that you say. But most importantly, that He will give you a new labor for the new year. That we will be about our Father's business. We will be into the highways and the byways and into this community. Communities up along the shore. And we will try to show forth the love of Christ. In everything that we say, everything that we do. No matter if it makes us liked or if it makes us unliked tonight. We need to be true to the message of Christ. We need to live our lives for Him. And for Him alone. So do you want a new you in 2017? It's a decision that only you can make tonight. I wonder, can we sing the chorus, "Oh, what a change, what a difference"?
Have a